Jesus said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, order your disciples to stop.' He answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out.'" On this Palm Sunday, as we worship, we sing the words that would have been shouting out at the time, "Hosanna." We come from singing, from hearing those first words of scripture about that entry into Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday, and we pray, bringing heart and mind together before God. Holy God, source, Savior, and Spirit of all life, Holy Three and Holy One, in you we confront the mystery of mercy and the courage of compassion. As we face the cross on which Christ gave himself, we confront your willingness to die for us so that we might find new life. As the Spirit speaks to us through the story of your amazing love, spilled out in the blood of Christ, our hearts are moved to praise you. Words cannot express our awe, the grief and the gratitude stirring within us for all you have given us and for all you will give us through such unspeakable love. We fall silent in wonder and praise, Holy God. Merciful God, filled with wonder and praise, we acknowledge to you how often we fall short of your purposes for us. We confess it is easier for us to follow the crowd than follow Christ. We prefer to avoid conflict rather than stand up for your mercy and understanding. We allow strident voices in our times to drown out your wisdom and truth. Forgive us, O God. Fill us with the courage to take up our cross and follow Jesus, even when the cost to follow is high and reputations are at stake. Gracious God, as we hear the stories of Jesus' final days again, Help us listen as if we had never heard them before. By the power of your Spirit, engage us, shock us, and pierce our hearts so that your undying love overwhelms us with mercy and grace through Christ, your living word. Amen. The Apostle Paul wrote, "This saying is sure and worthy of our full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. It doesn't matter how big or how small our sins, God's forgiving love in Jesus Christ can cover them all. Trust that in Christ we are forgiven. Be at peace with God, with yourself, and with each other." Our scripture reading takes us from what you heard earlier about the entry into Jerusalem to now the days that followed, in which Jesus is in front of Pilate and a trial is happening.
Today's scripture reading is taken from Luke chapter 23, verses 26 to 47. As they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' And they will begin to say, 'Mountains fall on us, and to the hills cover us.' For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it's dry? Two others also who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, 'Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing.' And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, 'He saved others, let him save himself if he's the Messiah of God, his chosen one.' Soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine, saying, 'If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself.' There was also an inscription over him, 'This is the King of the Jews.' One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, 'Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us.' But the other rebuked him, saying, 'Do not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation. And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong.' Then he said, 'Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' He replied, 'Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise.' It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3:00 PM, while the sun's light failed and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, saying, 'Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.' Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, 'Certainly this man is innocent.'" The word of God.
Not just once, but over and over again, in the trial against Jesus, Pilate spoke words that indicated Jesus was innocent. Whatever the chief priests, the leaders, the people were saying, Pilate could not find any reason to go through with the demands of those present. In one fell swoop, we have gone from crowds shouting, "Hosanna," to "Crucify him." Why? What happened in the week from Sunday through Friday? Well, the systems of power had their way, just as those systems have their way today. We don't get to look far, don't have to look far, to see how systems of power have made Putin think that he has every right to pillage the Ukraine. And this is just the latest in stories of refugees across the globe trying to find safety of people living in unjust societies and the vulnerable being the victims in the story of power and prosperity for those who have the privilege to call the shots, figuratively and literally. Those stories hit as close to home as the people on our streets, with everything in between. The spouse of the child who is battered and bruised, the manager who creates an environment of distrust and favoritism, or the hierarchies where you deal with the personalities that want to have control. Jesus died, not to pay a ransom for us and to make the cross simply a victory over evil. Jesus did not die because we have sinned and so we deserve to die and go to hell, and in some twisted way, Jesus' death allows God to forgive us so that we can go to heaven. This is not about debts and payments. And Jesus did not die to show us how we ought to love one another. That somehow the cross where Jesus gives his life for us is the ultimate expression of God's love that should inspire us to love others as God has loved us. This is not fully what the cross is about. Each of these thoughts about the cross has merit, is important. There can be a case made for each in the scripture, but no one of these ideas changes us. And what happens on the cross should change us. This isn't just thinking about the cross, which all of the ideas presented do, but rather we are called to experience the cross. Let's see if we can unpack this a little further, knowing that we are not likely to come to some ultimate understanding, but maybe go far enough to start to question and ponder the story of Holy Week from Palm Sunday through Good Friday to Easter Sunday in new ways, using a different lens that opens us up to life, to the life-changing experience of the cross. Jesus was innocent. We know that. Pilate said to the chief priests in the crowds, "I find no basis for an accusation against this man." And after Jesus had been to Herod and sent back to Pilate, again he says to the chief priests, the leaders, and the people, "You brought me this man as one who was perverting the people. And here I have examined him in your presence and have not found this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither is Herod, for he sent him back to us. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve death." And a third time, as the crowd shouts for Jesus to be crucified, Pilate says, "I have found in him no ground for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and then release him." But those in power and a riled up crowd took over, and to appease the people, Pilate gave in, sentencing Jesus to death on a cross, the most horrible death imaginable at the time. It was so horrible that by law, no Roman citizen could be put to death in this way. But Jesus was not a Roman. Jesus was a Jew. And the leaders in that religious element knew that the only way Pilate would be able to call, they knew that only Pilate would be able to call for the kind of death they were looking for. They wanted Jesus gone, done, out of the hair, and made an example of. But the thing about God is that God takes the most unimaginable situations and can bring life out of horror. It does not mean that people are spared horror. Even Jesus wasn't spared from death. But in Jesus' death, there was a promise. The promise of life that comes out of death. Something we don't get to understand without Easter. The cross makes us experience Jesus' death and resurrection. And it brings meaning and purpose to our own lived experiences of death and dying into moments of fruitful living. Think of the many ways we suffer and struggle. We fail ourselves, our loved ones. If you think that you are not one who fails, then you may need to truly examine your way of being in the world. None of us escapes the hardships that life presents, the losses, the broken relationships, the difficulties. What God does through the cross, what was done to Christ, was to offer life. That life comes through forgiveness, grace, and love. Think of Jesus' life. He went about healing, teaching, and feeding people, and everyone loves to hear those stories. But when Jesus offers forgiveness, people get upset. They ask, where does Jesus get off thinking he has the power to forgive sin? They don't want that kind of forgiveness. Because forgiveness means that we have done something wrong. We want to control our narrative. We want to be in charge of how we deal with all that happens to us and because of us. And it takes a lot to admit when one has committed an offense. Jesus says, you are loved and you are forgiven. And you get to live your life in the power and light of the cross. Something happened on that day when Jesus died on the cross. It was something profound, something that seizes us, redeems us, touches us. It cannot be explained by some theory or idea. Not that these aren't helpful in our conversations, but ideas are not life-giving. Jesus' death is what brings life. At 6 p.m. on that Friday evening, everything changed. The light of life went from Jesus, but it was only the beginning of a new life and light that was to emerge. In the coming days, I invite you to think about the cross. What made the difference that Jesus hung there and then lay in a cold tomb? Just look at the cross and ponder the fact that Jesus did this for you, for me. Because though his living was an example of how to be in the world, his death and resurrection say much more about the power of God to change us, to change how we live right now, today. It is God's power that makes all of the difference. It is greater than the most powerful leader, country, or system in the world. It is the power of life for every human being, everyone, each person, whether you know them or not, each person made in love, created by love, held by love. Come to the cross. Hear the words of the criminal who hung there with Jesus. This man has done nothing wrong. Jesus is innocent, but in love, meeting us where we are in our human flesh and frailness. Jesus takes on the cross, making it a symbol of life. And more importantly, changing our lives with its power to bring life out of death. This is Jesus. This is the cross. This is love. This is God come to us. Amen. As is the case every day, there's a need to pray for the people in our world, for the situations. And so we do that through the prayers of the people. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you came to us in humility, reaching out to all God's little ones with mercy and compassion. You ask us to do the same. So today we pray for all those who find themselves in humble circumstances, for the homeless in our community and for refugees wherever they take shelter, for the poor and all who find themselves without resources to cope these days, for those who live in isolated communities in Canada and around the world, lacking access to care, resources, and technology others take for granted. Strengthen them in your mercy and humble us, lest we forget how much we have to be grateful for. Lord Jesus Christ, hear us as we pray for all those who have been humbled by life's unexpected turns during the months of the pandemic. We remember before you those who face illness, pain, or injury, those who have known death or disaster, fear or failure, and all who struggle with anxiety and uncertainty. We pray for victims of crime and those who suffer through the misjudgment or mistake of others. And we pray for those who suffer because of the consequences of their own actions and choices. Embrace them in your mercy and humble us, lest we imagine we can live lives untouched by trouble. Lord Jesus Christ, hear us as we pray for those who have not learned the lessons of humility yet, for those who live carelessly or drive recklessly, endangering themselves and others, for those who abuse the trust and power in their positions, betraying those whose interests are in their hands. And we pray for those who mislead others for gain or indulge their fame with no thought for the example they set. Humble them in your mercy, and humble us if we are tempted to ignore the consequences of our own actions. Lord Jesus Christ, as we watch you walk to your cross this week, fill us with humble gratitude that you go before us into any challenge or crisis we may face. Give us courage to stand with others facing injustice or prejudice, and give us words to speak out for those at risk at home or abroad. For you have given us words to pray for the coming of your kingdom, your reign of justice, mercy, and peace. So we pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen. With thankfulness, we give in gratitude and joy. With prayerfulness, we give in sacrifice and love. With hopefulness, we give in commitment to God. I encourage you on this day, this Palm Sunday, to give as you are able to a congregation, one that may be your own or one that may be just needing some extra support, and you know that one is close to you and you can do so. If you would like to support St. Andrew's here in Thunder Bay for our ministry and our mission and our work, we would invite you to check out our website at standrewspres-tba.ca. There you can give by credit card, or you can find a way to e-transfer as well. There's a song that talks about the wounds that Jesus experienced. It's called, "What Are These Wounds in Your Hand, Dear Savior?"
Thank you.
peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Creator, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you always.